All right. Welcome back. I know I just kind of went on a tirade reading through the readmes. No big deal. Let's see if I can make some progress. Hopefully the video won't stutter this time. So, it's just commenting that there are tons of files in this directory. It's kind of difficult to keep track of what's here. And some of them have, like, you see there's gamedb underscore old dot c, there's playerdb underscore old dot c. It's unfortunate that that's just how the code phases from one format to a different. And it's still flickering. Let me see if I can up the bit rate, because that's really the only thing I can change at this point, I think. Unless I'm missing something. Let's boost that to 1,000 instead of 800. Maybe the encoder. What, can I see whether it flickers or not? I know I did see it briefly flicker that one time, but I'm really not sure what else I can do here. Yeah, so I bumped it from 800 to 1,000. I think anybody should have megabit internet, but if your poor modem can't take a megabit, I guess I could bump it down to 800 kilobits again. That's a shame too. Oh, I see, I see. Well, let me put it back down to 800. This is. Okay, I'm going to try a different preset of values. We're experimenting. We're down back to 800 kilobits per second. I've disabled low latency mode. So now there's a higher latency in the stream. Hopefully the encoder's more stable or something. That's a shame because every time Open Broadcaster software or OBS Studio comes up with a new release, they're always boasting about, oh, look how many great bugs we fixed. And they don't, I don't know. It just seems unrealistic that with every release they fix bugs without having potential to introduce bugs. So I've turned off low latency mode. If it's still doing that, I don't know how to fix that. The only other thing which is ever so slightly strange about this, and this really shouldn't be affecting anything, is that I have two terminals open. So here's the other terminal. I could dismiss that, because I'm not sure if I'm going to get to using this anyhow. Let's go back to the setup we were using the other day and see, like, if using a single terminal something that it's okay with. If it's flickering every 2 to 3 seconds, that would bug me as a viewer. The other terminal's not flickering. Oh, that's interesting. Well, guess what we're gonna do? We're gonna bring up a new terminal. So let's do that, and oops, and there we go, and move that onto the screen. Oh, come on. I can't click and drag things apparently with this cursor. Okay, let's kill this terminal. There's the other one. Let me full screen this stuff. Does this work any better? Or should I invoke a new window? Okay, this does capture. That's good. We got a new terminal here. I'm not sure if that's going to fix anything. Oh, okay. I'll make a note that whenever I come out of sleep mode and I'm recovering a terminal session, that it doesn't capture properly. That's really weird. So I should just, when bringing my computer out of sleep mode, rather than reconnecting on my old terminal, I should always just use a new one. That's how things work in the Windows world. You just learn to work around the issues. Okay. Don't get stuck in a closet. Wear yourself out. Truly famous words. You know, I should actually take the Lee Chess quotes, and I mean, they're all listed in the file, and I could make that as a source code, or I'm not a source code, a source data set for the Kaose command, or sorry, for the Fortune command that gets piped to Kaose. Yeah, no, I figured, oh, okay, at least that's more information. So that more information tells me that if you start typing things, now you've got all this content in the window. Somehow the encoder's struggling. Yeah, I was gonna say it's probably due to what I just changed. What I just changed is I typed some stuff and now we got all this text on the screen. So probably right. Yep, Zush arrives at the same conclusion. I was trying to explain it and he beat me to it. Well done. I'm not sure what else I can try. I could try a different encoder. Let's try the default encoder or encoding settings. If that fails, I can always start hitting buttons on the encoding settings, and rather than picking from presets, I can start changing things like do not enable two-pass encoding. Two-pass encoding is probably a bit much for what we're trying to do here. Hopefully that improves. If not, I'll keep hitting. Either that, or I could Google. I could do an internet search to see if I could find what's going on. But more likely than not, that would spring up many red herrings and not actually explain the situation I'm in, which is unfortunate. So, let's see. Git status shows where I left off yesterday. I did end up making a couple small changes after the stream. Yeah, of course, I updated the help documentation as well as the usage documentation. Spectacularly, both of those are incorrect. The only syntax which sort of works is examine board category. So, examine player 1, player 2, game number, journal slot does not work. Examine player 1, player 2, game number does not work. Examine B board category does not work. The only thing that does work is examine category board. Which I should actually update the documentation. I thought I did this yesterday. Apparently my memory has failed me in this regard, or something else is up. But yeah. Category always precedes board. Category, for example, would be wild, and board would be 5. Category could be 0, 1, and board would be 0. But I want to reintroduce the syntax of examine B category board. Right now it's just examine category board, which won't work once people start taking user accounts that have the same names as the categories. How to hack an email. Well, let's see. Man mail x mail. Oh man, I don't have any mail clients installed. But yeah, email's not a secure protocol. Don't believe anything that emails tell you. There are secure ways to transfer emails, but that does not mean that the whole mail protocol is secure. That just means the transferal of the mail is secure. So, when somebody sends an email saying that they're from DC, or saying that they're from some research station in Antarctica, or saying that they're a Nigerian prince, there's no way to authenticate that sort of thing. Unless you happen to know who that person already is to begin with. And then you could have PGP assigned emails. Can I hack? Anybody can hack. It's true. It is known. Now, as for whether it's a useful investment of time to be performing hacks, who was it the other day? I think there's a Twitch streamer by the name of Jabu, J-A-B-U, who I believe does hacking for a living. He does it more so with hardware than with software, but you might still find what he does interesting. Like I said, anybody can hack. You're really not being very specific here. And I'm sorry if I'm being a little uncooperative in the way I'm speaking, but I could spend many, many minutes digressing onto what it even means. And I'm actually having an agenda here. So otherwise, I would probably take you up on the offer of discussing whether or not I can hack. I mean, I've written a compiler. I've assembled hardware that does computation of really primitive sorts. I've written in assembly. I've even developed my... Well, no, that's part of the whole writing a compiler thing. I've done a great many things that have to do with computing, both at high and low levels. So if I felt motivated, sure, of course I could hack. But that's probably not the answer you're looking for. You're actually looking for, have you like hacked into anybody else's sites? And I just have no motive to do that. In fact, you'll note that do I have this here? Git log. So I have all these contributions I made to the code. One of them was automatic binary hardening. Yeah. So I actually made this particular server hack proof using C techniques that help prevent accidental elevations and privilege. You're being really vague. I'm not sure if you have malicious intent or not, and I'm not like seeking to do anything malicious. So I mean, hacking is just so overrated. Fact, now I have to go pull up the comic. So here we go. XKCD hacking. Is this the one I think it is? Yes. There we go. Here we go. This is hacking in a nutshell. Thanks to Randall Munroe for this comic. Hackers briefly took down the website of the CIA yesterday. What people here? Oh my God! Hackers hacked! What computer experts here? Someone tore down a poster. Oh no. Okay, you're motivated to learn more and you're doing school projects. Interesting. So I did take like a system administration class regarding how to set up and properly secure machines. If you fail to secure them, there's all kinds of vulnerabilities that computers could be subject to. If you just do an internet search for the word vulnerability, and you'll find every bug ever that was ever fixed or not fixed. So those millions of pieces of data could explain a good many things. Yeah, right. So, where is I gonna do this stuff with the server here? First of all, is the server up and running? I forgot to check that. Server is up and running, but I have no idea which server that is, so I'm gonna stop it. Then we're gonna go into the directory, make install. Start the server. And so now the server's up and running. Okay, have fun. Don't get in trouble. And I'm not condoning anything you're suggesting anyway, but whatever. It's Telnet localhost 5000. Oh, okay, I was gonna say, what the heck? I thought I was connecting to the server. Helps. Oh, I actually need to type help because my aliases don't stick. I was gonna use the other syntax. So, I was gonna say style 10 or tw I'm sorry, 12 was what I was thinking of. Style 1 is a standard ICS board in ASCII format, and that's the default style. But is it the default? What is my style? My style is 12. So the client must have changed it to 12 last time, and that's okay. This will show me the raw dump, which is actually what I'm most interested in. So let's match ourselves. I was trying yesterday, I think it was Wild Space Sierra 1. Problem loading board, game aborted. So I'm not sure why that failed, but we did get problem loading board, game aborted. And if we check, oh, that didn't have any logging. If we check here, here's the big ol' log. tried to read Chesty Data Board's CR1, which is incorrect. Let's see, loading from category CR1, board CR1, which is why that failed. The board is called CR1/0. So why did that fail? Grep chestd problem. Since that's part of the error message, this is going to help us track back what part in the code this failed at. And I think this would actually, well, I'm not sure. You know, I should give each one of those a different number in its message. Wait, game aborted, examine aborted. Ah, I did change the message in OBSPR PROAC. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. Obviously, this is meant for procedures for observing games. I could call it OPSPROC or whatever. It doesn't matter because it's not a word. Chesty problem is what we're looking for. So I mean, I don't know whether to give the dude grief or not, because frankly, I was at college, I had to do some similar hacking things, but that was in the context of a class where you're supposed to secure your computers and then see if you can hack your fellow students' computers. It was an interesting environment. It could have been a lot more interesting if my peers were better at computers, but whatever. So we're picking, away at this code, trying to figure out where it logged this. Loading from category, it's good. But somehow we got board is equal to CR1, which is not what we should have ended up with. I'm not sure which of these two branches it went to. And I probably should add some logging here. So have I missed anything? Wait. Yeah, now if I said wild CR1, copy category into board. Yeah, here's what we're gonna do. Now, I probably need to do some translation before I get to that point in the code, right? So, I'm not sure why this is coded the way it is. This is still fine though. So if we have SC as the category, we fill in board 0 and then we change the SC into CR1, but I think I probably want this just last, so there's the least chance of me confusing myself reading it. How much do I know about AI? Well, I think the A stands for artificial. No. No, I know a lot. Sure. Why not? I know everything there is to know about AI. I'm trying to think, like, how do I even quantify that? Either I'll know what you're talking about or I won't, so if you have a question, feel free to ask, I guess. Spend a lot of time tinkering with it, and I'm aware of some developments in the AI arena. Most entertaining have been the StarCraft AI contests, as well as Elon Musk's OpenAI gym, which I spent a little time with. I just don't have enough time for it, but it still sounds really cool. A little disappointed that he's partnered with Microsoft, but I guess he had to partner with somebody to help realize his vision. Yeah, I've seen a number of videos regarding deep learning and neural networks. I've read several academic papers on the subject. I think most convincing in this area, or at least easiest for a general public member to understand, would be I'm trying to remember who it was. I feel bad about that, but somebody put up a YouTube video about how to use neural networks to perform machine learning for games like Mario and Mario Kart. Or I'm sorry, Super Mario World and Mario Kart. So that's just giving a really high-level insight as to what neural networking is. You could just look at those videos and see how it trains the AI to learn over time. I have started to dabble in TensorFlow, as well as the TFLearn library that makes TensorFlow more accessible for people like me who don't have all day to read all the documentation. I guess honestly, were I a student or a grad student, I'd probably have the time to dig really deep into TensorFlow and understand all its nuances. But given my position, I have to fall back to other content providers, people like a YouTube streamer who goes by the name of Siraj, Siraj. If you search for what he's done quite a bit to try to make machine learning accessible to people. Just in terms of how do you type the keys on the keyboard to make things happen. He does try to explain some of the theory too, but you really have to get invested in the theory to understand that. Yeah, in that case, I would recommend that, I think he calls his series Sirajology. And while his early videos are laughably, oh man, I struggle to come up with a neutral word to describe it. But like some of his early videos explain how to learn, understand, and code or something, a extremely complex concept in under 2 minutes. The word disingenuous seems kind of appropriate, even though he's not trying to mislead anybody. Yeah, no, his early videos are hilariously not instructive. And yeah, I agree with that criticism, but I think if you look at what he's done, not in terms of those early videos, but just as his live sessions, he's a little bit better at explaining things. He's still trying to get the hang of it. He's not very good at that either, but rather, he's not very focused. He's about as focused as Zug is from time to time. So, his live sessions do get content across, do show live examples and how they work. But, honestly, I wish I had time to do this some sort of instructive live streaming with that sort of thing. Let me see if I can find. One of his live sessions was actually particularly useful. I think it had something to do with a poll cart, POLE cart, and just showing how to use TensorFlow to have a machine learn how to balance a poll on top of a cart. The cart slides left and right, the poll is under the force of gravity, and so it's tricky. Like, if you've ever tried balancing a pencil on your finger, you'll know that it is tricky to balance that sort of thing. But anyway, yeah, honestly, I think I need to have a go at some of that because, as great as he's done showing people how to type the keys on the keyboard, and as articulate as he attempts to be in explaining things, I think I could do better in some ways, and perhaps not as good in others. But I think I could perhaps explain some of the theory just based on my own background in computer science. I think I'd have a real shot at providing content that could explain the deeper nuances of this stuff. That all said, it'd be really helpful. Like, I don't know if you're just trying to learn the concepts in general, or if you have a particular problem you're attempting to apply them to. Lichess is also interested in neural networks for obvious reasons. Obvious reasons being they have enormous data sets and they want to be able to better filter that data to prioritize help in various ways. One way would be automatically identifying out of all the cheater reports who's the most suspicious. So, if progress is made on that front, I very well may try to explain on my stream how that all works. And the beautiful thing is that it would be safe for me to do so, because you would need the entire data set of what Lichess has data-wise for anybody to beat the system. And over time, it's just going to become impossible for any cheater to get away with it. There's just too much data and not enough. Let's see. Nobody's got the capability that Lichess has, or at least those who do are very few. Do I log things? Also, why am I not doing server-side logging for... Oh, of course. No, that's fine. I understand why the original author didn't want to do server-side logging for that, but I'm actually interested in it. Though that's not a helpful piece of feedback here. I need the entire command. Is there anything else I could do here? Because I don't have visibility to the commands here. Category board, that all makes sense. Except I want to call this param 0, param 1, and then reference them accordingly over here. Param 1 dot val dot string, and param 0 dot val dot string. And unfortunately, in fact, let me do that up here. I have no way of counting how many parameters there are, but should be useful context anyhow. Make stop. Make install. Start. Telnet, localhost, 5000, admin, get me in there. Okay, it doesn't remember commands from old times because it's not a full-fledged client. What do I do here? Oh, match myself, wild, 0-1. Okay. Yeah, technically nothing is impossible. It's just an arms race. I misspoke. Most people attempting to get away with cheating would be like bringing a... I was going to say bringing a knife to a gunfight. I'm not sure if there's a better way to describe it, but... Lee Chess has just such an enormous data advantage that... It'd be like trying to beat Google at Google search. Yeah, OpenAI Gym is awesome. The other day I did mention that to Zog, just, you know, if he does have free time and he's interested in coding and doesn't mind the time sink, he could get into that sort of stuff too. Not that I'm advocating he goes into that, because I don't know if it takes a lot of focus to get anywhere with this OpenAI Gym. I did spend some time trying to make progress with it, and it was challenging. That's for sure. TF Learn does try to make that a lot easier, and hopefully more examples with TF Learn will be forthcoming. Oh, sure. Yeah. Yeah, if you've got a cluster of computers and you've got a database of lots of human games, if you've got all that computing power, by all means, you can try. You can certainly try. And in fact, if you end up succeeding in making a bot that plays like a human, okay, I'm actually impressed by that. Lee Chess, probably not so much. I personally think that, well, as long as your opponent thinks that you're a legit human player, mission accomplished. Now, that's kind of a negative attitude, but that's also why I've been calling on Lee Chess for years now to stop saying that engines are bad and just say, okay, you want to be proud of the fact that you're an engine. Okay, you can be proud of that. We'll label you as such. You won't appear on the leaderboards. You won't be able to accept most rated games. Maybe even most unrated games. And you'll have your own category for just who you are. And you can be special like that. Just being a computer. And I think that would take away some of the motivation for people... I don't know, who use computers just to get their name to the top of the rankings. They can have a separate ranking list for people using computers. I don't see what the issue is with that, but Lee Chess apparently has some issue with it. Anyhow, I'm meant to check out what's in my journal. Okay, so param 0 is admin, param 1 is wildcr1. Interesting. No, there still isn't a way to do that. No, there's just too much of a stigma, and I don't know why Lee Chess continues to perpetuate that as a stigma. But as long as Lee Chess keeps saying that engines are bad and it's cheating, and it's against the terms of service, and making all these statements about how terrible engines are as opponents, it's going to be difficult to for the sort of thing you're asking for to happen. Let's see. Well, that's kind of cool, though. It says, like, command not found ls. So there's some way for it to be able to log every command that's issued. not just part of the command, but the full command right there. But whatever. Yeah, it does. I guess the only thing that mitigates that somehow is it would be difficult to interface with Lee Chess as an engine anyway. And so you're not going to find very many people interested in that sort of thing anyway. And, you know, Lee Chess is the state of the art. And maybe one day somebody else, I'm not even motivated to do it, but maybe somebody will. They'll come up with a new server, they'll have better rules, that sort of thing. It could happen. I'm probably not motivated to do or even try such a thing because it's such a huge endeavor. But yeah, I've tried to make my point known, and I think my point's known to them, but I'm not sure where to go next with it. Certainly not taking it to Reddit, unlike some chess strong players who like to take things to Reddit and be big babies when they don't get their way. For better or for worse, they do that, but just the whole tone of that is it's overdone. And there's just not a better way to resolve it at the moment. So, argument zero was PP, well, it was admin. And admin does match the player name. Is this, how does this work? So, I forget how the match command works. It's match opponent. Then time control, right? And then the board type, if I remember right. Well, what all this code here is attempting to do is say, if parameter 0 is the player name, skip it and go on to the next parameter. Where is val declared? Val is declared up there. Okay, it's not initialized to anything, it's just declared. So the point of this is we're able to check if val has a value or if it's just null. I think I could set here equals null pointer. Wait, is that not the syntax for null pointer? Grep null pointer stuff. Grep I null pointer? Okay, fine. So apparently that's not a thing. Is null a thing? Null is definitely a thing. Okay, that's cool. Does this file have any examples? Yeah, so I did the right syntax. I might be. Is that an issue? I just don't, yeah, whatever. I mean, he's not the only person to have done it. He's just the most popular person to have done it. So, this here should be like that, and then we say if val is not equal to null, then do all the following. And then up here, here's what we do. Easy. If I remember, wait, is this what I want? Actually, why does it matter? Wouldn't you want parameter 1 value string anyway? Oh, I'm sorry. Hang on. This here deals with the case where this string, the first thing, is not a player name. If you first thing is a player name, then we fall into this stuff down here. But otherwise, examine this also does not work up here. This should be examine B and then the whole variant stuff. So, how do I eat this B that precedes the category and board name? Well, first of all, I've not tested it. I should see what happens if I use examine rather than. Let's try this. Quit. Telnet will post 5,000. Yeah, this session has been anything but instructive. Oh well, what can I do? Examine B, CR1, quit. I've successfully been not productive. Taking off point would be assuming I had a point to begin with, which I might not have. Wait, what? Param 0 is admin. Oh, I'm sorry, that was the other command. I'm confused. So, why did that not log? What time is it? It's. Yeah, does this match up with the log? Our newest session started down here. Could not open file BCR1. So, we didn't even hit the line of code that gets the two parameters because it concluded that there is no board BCR1 before we even could get there. How did it conclude that? Examine. Oh, command examine. Okay, it's the end of this. Com examine is how you find the examine command. Okay. So, this is going to get complicated really quickly because I'm not familiar with this section of code yet. I don't know its structure very well. So, if the player's game is greater than or equal to zero, so I guess if they means, yeah, they're already playing a game or examining a game, so they can't issue an exam command. Else, if parameter zero type is null, just bring up a raw examine board. Else, if you have an argument, parameter one type. Okay, if you have a single parameter and parameter 0 is equal to the word setup, bring up a setup board, I guess. Else, now we're looking at this here, if param 1 type is equal to word type. So we have two parameters. Actually, this is redundant, is it not? Param 0.type is equal to type null, else if parameter 0.type is not equal to type null, Do they have another condition for if it's maybe equal to type null? Just let me go down here. No. Yeah, now this is redundant. It's redundantly redundant. There we go. So if we have a parameter, and this checks the condition if parameter one type is equal to null, and meaning we don't have a second parameter, and parameter zero is equal to the word setup, just bring up a examine board in setup mode or something. Else, if parameter one type is a word, then look for, okay. See, now we're talking. This is not right. This does not match the documentation. So, how does this work? There's an ambiguity in this syntax. So, usage. I think I have this documented up here. Let's just grab this comment and stick it down here. So this is what we're attempting to parse, and apparently you can do also examine setup. I'm not sure why that's special. So if not find player, param zero val word. Return command OK. So if that player does not exist, a message was sent out that the player does not exist. What message did I end up getting back from the server anyway? It was telling me something. There is no player matching that name. So it outright told me there's no player matching that. Thankfully, this block of code ends. So you can actually fit it on the screen. So, yeah, now obviously we're not going to find this, we're not going to find anything here if, so parameters would be things after the examine command, I think I want to check is parameter one equal to the letter B. And if so, take the next two parameters. Oh, sorry, parameter zero is the letter B. So take the next two parameters and try to find that as a board, as per the documentation. Let's see, what else? If parameter one, the second parameter is of type int. Look in the history of a player to try to find a game. Else, if parameter one is a word, check the journal for the letter. Else, examine an adjourned. Oh, yeah, if we find a game, then examine it as an adjourned game. P2CONN. Oh, right. So if we're not using players one and or two. Deallocator free up their memory structures. So, Do I want to go in here just yet? No, I want to do another check here. Something. If not, stir comp B. And then parameter 0 dot val dot string or something. I'm not sure what the difference is between string and word. But it seems that when we're comparing values out of parameters, oh no, here we actually do use word for that. I'm not sure if the order of these matters. Grep stir comp in obs proc.c. That's fine. Usage is the thing that we're going to search for now. And parameter one type is type word. But that's not sufficient. Trying to figure out what's the syntax this dude uses for an if statement that overflows. I guess this just lines it up like this. Oh, but I don't need to check that. There we go. How many string buffers do I have allocated here that I might be able to use? So we're going to say now if parameter 2 dot type is not equal to type null, we're going to check for things one way and say else. We have null. Let's check it positively rather than negatively. So over here we can't param 2.val.word because we don't have that. That's fine, I think. If file exists. Now, I'm not so sure. Actually, do I need to... Yeah, I do need to check both values, don't I? That's unfortunate. Well, I could check these one at a time. It wouldn't hurt for me to do that, in fact. File exists is defined in proto.h. Oh, we don't have a thing as directory exists. Okay, grep file exists star.c. It's defined in utils.c, which is where I expected to find it, but. Yeah. F open. So I have to open the file. I don't have a way of just checking if a directory exists. That's a bummer. I'm not sure how to write a platform independent directory checker. I mean, I could probably game that into if file exists somehow, but I'm not going to do that. So, let's see. What do we want to do now? Okay, so now we're able to get into here. And see where it says param 0, param 1, and all that stuff. Meaning up here, now I need to write the parser for examine B. Hang on. No, I don't. There's a shortcut. There is definitely a shortcut here. This is cool, if I understand correctly. Then why should I expect there to be any parameters at all? I need to check that case. That string. Okay, this is going to overflow. I need to add more parentheses because this is going to become an OR statement. And what we're going to check is if parameter 0's type is equal to a word, and if that word is equal to the letter B. Just skip the stuff up top. In fact, now there isn't a single valid case for going into this branch of code. So what I want to do next is rewrite this whole expression in a more cogent fashion. So if blah blah blah. Condition A is going to be if parameter 0 dot type is equal to type word, and that word is equal to the letter B. So that's one condition under which we'd want to do an examination. Another condition under which we'd want to do that would be, actually this is the same thing. So what I'm basically doing is rewriting this. I actually wrote this statement incorrectly here. I would need to negate this whole thing to say, if this is untrue, then fall in here, else fall down here. Okay, we're getting closer. Oh yeah, and we'd only want to do any of this if we have a second parameter. So if parameter 1 dot type is not equal to type null, and we meet some other condition. Parameter 0 dot type is equal to type word, and parameter 1 type is not null. That's all good. And either this condition where we've got B as the word, or this other condition where do I need all these parentheses? This is really confusing. There we go. So value 0 is equal to a player name, or it's equal to the letter B. In either case, we're going to be examining a thing. This is perhaps too lax. But yeah, there's a reason I wanted all this to fan in together. And that's because you shouldn't be able to, as the category name, put an integer. So I shouldn't be able to say examine B10 Sierra 1, because 10 is not a category type. Also, this has the flexibility that it can handle there being either just the category or the category and the board specified. So you could say, I want, we have all kinds of categories, like, I'm struggling to explain that because I don't know. Okay, well, I guess you could say there's like Crazy House, and there's just the normal Crazy House, and then there's like Crazy House Shogi, and then there's Crazy House other kinds of boards that drop pieces on the board. I'm not sure if that's the actual domain of data values, but there's a default value in each category. So I've changed the syntax up here. We no longer have to have both a category and a board. It's sufficient to just specify a category and assume that the board is just the default board, which is zero. Or you could say, examine B wild 5. And I'm not sure if wild has a default. It'd be interesting if the default wild could be that crazy wild variant or variation or whatever it's called, which just randomly picks a wild. Yeah. We could say wildly, or at random. At random is probably more accurate. So, let's see. Yeah, if we've got parameter 0's type is a word, and parameter 1's type is, we've got a parameter 1, and parameter 0 it's either the letter B or it's a player name, or not just any player name, but this player's name, then fall into the following. That still might be too strict. It's probably fine to say, you know, if parameter 0 is pretty much anything and parameter 1 is set, then bother parsing the rest of it. Oh. Hang on. What I'm not handling here is the case where you might try to specify examine B and then not specify the category. How do we handle that? So, oh, that is handled here though. See, yeah, we only try to examine a game if you've actually specified stuff. What else have I changed down here? So if you just use the word examine, where does that put you in this whole shebang? So if parameter 1's type is null. Oh, okay, here's the whole, just the word examine. Just by itself. We just bring up the examine board. You don't have any control after that. Examine setup brings up an examine board in setup mode. That's cool too. Now that returns com okay. I guess these have to return prematurely because in order to avoid the rest of what's down here. Be nice if I could reformat some of this down here, because that's a lot of code all being done in the same branch. There might be ways I can meaningfully break this up. So I could say else if something here, and then say else if another thing here, and then have the else condition overall. That would just go, say, here. I'm trying to figure out how to format this without derping in some epic way. So you could try this, and just gotta be really careful while making these changes. Else if that. There we go. Whoops. Being careful not to change the meaning of this while I'm re-indenting things. So, that, I think, at least in my mind, that's less ambiguous. These are all mutually exclusive anyhow. Oh, hang on. Hang on. I changed something functionally. What I changed? Well, no. I'm actually satisfied with this. So if somebody says examine B and then anything after that, where B is the entire word of the entire value of that parameter, then do not attempt to process B as a player name. We're just going into this branch. That's cool. So this says else of examine setup. But this requires that the next parameter be blank. I don't understand why you would require that. I mean, you're never going to have a player name by the name of setup. Yeah, I think, like, really, if you're trying to protect against something stupid happening, the way to protect it would be to put something in this branch of code. So for whatever reason, you really need that, need to verify that no extra arguments were provided. This is a safer way to perform such that comparison. And I don't know if the ordering of those terms in the that expression matters to the compiler, but I'm going to leave that ordering be. See if the parameter 0 is equal to the word setup. Not sure what the point of this other check was, because like if they say examine setup and they say other things. I mean, maybe they're trying to specify a variant or something. There might be a better way I can do all that. Can I put the player? I don't even know if it's legitimate to go into examine mode with a variant. That might be something worth thinking about. That might be the reason for that comparison, is so that if somebody says examine, they could go into setup mode and specify the board or category type. Although I'm not, though that gets really complicated though. Like with all these boards, you have preset sets of data, like not only the initial not only the rule set, but the initial position. And for some of these, the initial position is a pretty fundamental part of the variant. Like an odds game, you can't say just set up an odds game and do it in setup mode and then start changing how many pieces each player has. So I think that's fine. I also think it's redundant to do this check here. For some reason we're doing it. If we don't check in the rest of these, let me get rid of that check. I think that'll serve us well. Oh, but then we don't need this premature return statement. Go all the way down here. Return com okay, sure. Wait, does it always return com okay? Just by default? Yeah. So there's no way for this to indicate that the command failed. That's wonderful. But in turn, that means that this gets simpler because we don't need to return com OK because com OK is the default value. And the point of returning is not so much to get the correct value to be returned as it is to to ensure that the function returns early. So I'm going to move some code around like that. So rather than doing negative logic, we're going to do positive logic. So else if we find the player, then do some more stuff. Now, I don't like this kind of syntax where you have braces on some lines but not on others. I think it's useful that if you're putting a else end brace or start brace here, there should be an end brace preceding it, and therefore on the first line there should be a brace. It's not necessary, but it helps people who read code to figure out what's going on. Do we have another find player command? Yeah. Find player. If not P1 connection, player remove P1. Wow. Okay. My goodness, you could not have made this more confusing. I now understand that player remove does not deallocate the request object blanks out the parameter that's in the request such that there's no attempt to use that, or I'm sorry, such that the board object or whatever can be reused. I don't know. Basically, we're clearing up things that we don't need anymore. So, else if we have a word, else what's P2 equal to? Is P2 just a null pointer? P2 is equal to P. P is equal to whatever value gets passed into com examine. So I'm not even going to touch that, but, so there's some cases where we do want to call this, even though we don't have a second parameter. See, in my mind, the way I would have written this to avoid, like, 10 lines of code being in an else block would be, like that. Then we don't need this and that to be in an else block. Although I guess we're freeing up things later, so we still need to call this player remove thing down here after we're done. I did functionally change one stupid little detail. That's a bother. So, wait, no, I didn't change that though. Functionally, if we fail to find the player, P1CONN might be set to false. I don't know, but player one remove, or player remove P1 is never executed. So this is functionally equivalent. What's not equivalent is adding that comma OK, and then never calling this later. So this is just a simpler way to write the code. I should leave things be as they are now before I break something. Because I'm good at breaking things. One could even say I'm a hacker. And now we've gone full circle. Okay. Return with the value in a function returning void. Command.h, or stored mail moves, fine. Examine scratch. The address of category will always evaluate as true at line 609. Let's take a look at that. Is that true? The address of category will always evaluate as true. Oh yeah, you're right. Because we've allocated category inside this function. So yeah, the address of category always evaluates is true. It's probably not what we're trying to do. This should probably say if we have a category that consists of a string which is not an empty string, then do that. Alright, what warnings do we get now? And stored mail moves. I didn't write stored mail moves. I didn't write old mail moves. Didn't write find history or find history 2. Mm-hmm. 1086 though, and 1090. Let me just take a quick look at 1086 and 1090. Yeah, so this is just telling you can't return a value from a function which has no return, or has a void return type. You have to be really careful with how you speak about C. It's really picky. Let's stop the server. Make install, start the server, and yeah, now let's log in. Oh no, I have to update the documentation. So examine admin. I'm sorry, I should say examine B wild CR1. It tells me that's not valid. I'm not sure why it's telling me that's not valid. So let's decide there. If anything. Examine. Well, okay, now that was much earlier. Yeah, so okay, that server log didn't log anything. Examine B wild CR1 failed. So we didn't even hit this line of code. Why not? So, if we have no parameters to examine command, fallen here. Else, if we have a parameter and its value is setup, Oh man, I should check this stuff first, shouldn't I? SFRAM 0.type equals type word, and that, do that stuff. Else, if that, let's put this over here because we're going to need to add more to this condition. And param 1.type equals type word. Or type string, I suppose. We'll say it's not equal to type null. How about that? Will that suffice? Probably not. Oh, actually, that might work. Somehow that might work. Maybe I'm too optimistic here. Let's try that, I suppose. No, I'll leave that check in. It doesn't hurt to have that. I think there's a difference between a word type and a string type, in that a word could be just one word, and that a string could consist of multiple words. Let's remove some of the type safety. Type safety is no fun. Actually, I don't know. Let's leave that there. I don't know how best to handle this. I need to add more logging. That's what I need to do. Where did I put my command, my logger up here? I'm just going to put that right over here. So I know we've been using string for some time there. Let's try using word. Let's see what we get. Because the rest of this function seems to parse things at a word-by-word level. So there's no reason to do string parsing in one context and word parsing in a different one. Let's do this word-by-word and see what we get. Stop the server, make install, start the server, and just log in, and then we say examine bees wild 01. And exit and take a look at the server log, and hopefully it'll tell us something this time. Probably not. No, so this didn't actually, this seemingly did not log the extra thing I told it to log, which is really confusing in my mind. So how is it that we failed to get to that line of the code? What is it that dictates whether or not we get into comExamine? Command list. Try to keep it in alphabetical order, sure. Parameter string format. Word, an optional word, blah, 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 blah. So, an optional word and N being a number? Optional word or integer. Okay. So, how do I do this now? So the examine command is now always going to require a word, whether it's just the letter setup. Hey, look, we spelled a word here, W-O-N. Not intentionally. But it's either going to be the letter B or the word setup, and then an optional word being the category type or the player name. Oh, sorry, no, this could be... Yeah, let's... obsproc.c. So there are multiple uses just as an examine command. It can be used just by itself. So actually, that first parameter should be optional. It can accept one parameter being a player name. Sorry about that. It can accept two parameters, one being a player name. Oh, sorry. Examine player one. I'm not sure what examine player one does. Perhaps tries to examine the most recent. See if this is actually implemented. Hang on. What matters most is how we handle the text that's incoming. So else, if we find the player name, if we have some kind of parameter here, wait, where does this brace match up with? That there. Okay. Yeah, so you can do examine and just a player name. You can do examine B and board information. You can just do raw examine command. And that by itself should bring up just an examine board with all the default settings. So over here, this should be optional, possible optional integer at the end. For like wild 5 or wild 4 or wild 2, or just categories which have boards which are specified by an integer. N could also be a word. So it could be a word, could be an integer. So I think that's the right way to handle that. It's an interesting grammar for sure. Get status. Make, get add, get status, just to check where we're at now. Everything's in queue to be committed. And let's start the server and see if I can issue this command again. Telnet localhost. And I should be able to do examine brings up an examine board, unexamines the board, examine B, there's no player matching the name B, I don't like that, examine B Sierra Juan brings up the board for Sierra Juan chess. Examine B wild Sierra Juan. It does nothing. Examine wild Sierra Juan. Yeah, there's no player matching the name wild, which is good. So examine mode for boards is still not working properly. ICS is not rejecting my syntax. Probably logging more than I need to. Okay, cannot open file boards wild CR1. Or parameters for that be wild. Okay. We're making progress. Slowly but surely. Oh, I forgot I'm doing the whole double logging thing. So I added this logging because we weren't getting into the whole setup function thing. So if the file exists, we're going to attempt to bring up an examine board. This seems right. Oh, but here we need to do the special stuff for that we're doing also in the other function. Come back here in a minute. Special stuff being this stuff here. That if wild is the category, we're going to change the category to that. Arguably, this is a better place to do that. So. And that only works for some values of board, apparently. So. Oh, so much. Else if we're going to compare does this function do any other string comparisons? No, so I'll do it in the same style as this syntax here, which is going to be parameter 1.val.word is equal to wild and parameter 2.val.word is equal to 01. And do this check. Let's check that. And yeah, I think that should be fine. Let's stop the server one more time. Make install, start the server, log in. And now we can examine the wild CR1. Brings up a board for CR1 chess, right? Or is that just a normal chess board? That looks like a normal chess board. Loading from category wild, board blank. That's not correct. Examine B01. Again, that appears not to have loaded a CR1 board, although I'm not sure at this point. So that fails. Strange. Very strange. Well, hopefully the logging is going to be more revealing at this point. CR1 null, no such file or directory. Okay. We can deal with that. Oh, hang on, that's interesting. I hadn't thought of it that way. So now if I go back down here, word might be blank, but string will tend not to be blank. Interesting. How else? What else do I need to check here? If primer okay, so though this won't end up in the null condition here. The value of word might be null if we pass in an integer rather than a word. So what do I do here? Only the last argument, only argument at position 2 can be an integer. This is good. I think what I've coded hasn't broken any of the existing examine functionality. And what have I done up here? If parameter zero is type, well, yeah, no, if we have anything in parameter zero that's not null, it's of word type. If we have anything in parameter one that's not null, that's also a word. So all this is overdone, extremely so. Furthermore, this isn't really designed to handle player names because that's handled in the other function. This, it just does an examine from scratch. So this, you're not going to find any player name inside this particular examine command. What you are going to find is this here. Let's get rid of that. Merging this together. That's what this function's about, is just that sort of thing. That's all we're ever going to see here. Parameter zero is always going to be of type word. It's always going to be the letter B. Parameter one. Do I even need to check that here? Well, it doesn't hurt to check it, but of type. Well, not always. Keep forgetting this case. Yeah, let's not necessarily delve into the full details of everything there. Do I need? I do need to specify a board or a category. At bare minimum. So this should be okay. And what a headache. Progress is being made. we're doing better and better loading these boards in response to the various commands. This whole iterative approach seems kind of crazy. Yeah, okay, I guess we still need this iterative thing because the board itself could be an integer or it could be a word. I think either of which could be successfully loaded as a string, but it's probably okay. As long as we're not trying to use param 0 anywhere, we should be okay. That's complicated, isn't it? Loading from category CR1 board dot. So let's just increment those and get more info this time. Make stop, make install, start. It's difficult to code and comment at the same time. Salmon B101. Yes, it's. I'm curious why that failed. Okay, so we did successfully read those two parameters. As for why it's attempting to load the incorrect thing, I'm not sure. Hang on, it's not even possible to get into this case anymore, is it? This whole can't interpret integer in examine command should never be happening now. I don't need to remove this check, but it's good to know. Wait, which of these is the source and which of these is the destination? Could somebody remind me of how that works? Man, str copy. Destination comma source. Did I get this backwards? No, this is actually right. So now we're going to log this stuff, category, comma, board, and we'll take a look at what we got. See how it is that my code has failed me, because apparently it has. Shouldn't matter either. Okay. Actually, let's do it like that. That's more explicit. But. Yeah. Keep things simple. In this case, we're going to initialize things in one place if they haven't been initialized, and so that's fine. stop the server again. Make install. Start the server. Run the test one more time. Here's the command we've been running the whole time. And now we need to check, what was it trying to invoke? See, that's not what I would have expected. Examine category wild, board blank. Very much not what I would have expected. How did this fail? Well, figuring that out is going to require putting in more logging statements and figuring out exactly where something went wrong here. You see that parameter 1 is indeed wild, parameter 2 is indeed 0-1. Oh, because I changed the specification in the file. Right. Oh, so what broke this? You won't believe this. Even after I tell you. What must have broken this? Was this change I made here, where I said word, optional word, optional word, optional word or number. This in turn broke a 2-parameter phrase into a 3-parameter phrase. And so, well, hang on. This actually could be different now. If we start allowing players to look through their history, it's going to have to be O-N-N instead of O-O-N. But optional word, optional word or numbers. They could say, look at player game 5. And they could say, look at player versus player. They could also say, look at the game of a given type. Well, you get the picture. Examine is kind of an overloaded command, and that's making this tricky to write a parser for. But what I did break was the fact that now parameters 1 and 2 could be pretty much of any type. But also, that's not what I meant to say, but parameter 1 here is no longer the string that contains the rest of the text. Parameter 1 is just a word. It's always a word here. So we never care what parameter 0's type is. Parameter 0, this is actually going to get really simple now, I think. And parameter 1.type. Hang on. So if we've got a parameter 0, if parameter 1.type is equal to type int, confused is equal to 1, else, actually no, I should do this not using negative logic, but positive logic. Um, Positive logic would say that's going to be our category if it's a word. Okay, so let's do param one that veil that word. And I guess I'm gonna add in braces here, even though I don't. It's gonna get ugly a little bit, but simple, yes. Ugly, sure. And we're gonna say if parameter two's type is equal to a word. Copy it as a word, I guess, as the board. Otherwise, if it's an integer, I'm not sure what to do about that. It's not the correct syntax at all. I'll probably do it this way anyhow. And yeah, if we are confused, in fact, we don't need to have this variable called confused anymore, because that can only happen in one way. There's only one way we can end up confused, and that's if our parameters are invalid. So let's get rid of that variable. Do we need int g? That be the g, man. Oh, g equals game new. Okay, so yeah, we do need that. Hey, it's actually starting to wrap this up because I'm going to have to go to work soon. Oh, okay, cool. That is the... that's the last thing I would have expected people watching code being written, but I suppose I'm rambling, so that makes some sense. Okay, that's funny. I mean, gosh, that's the last thing I ever would have expected there. I guess I don't care if it's a word or an int. As long as it's not null. Yes, there is a point to this. The point is that if you parse this one word or a letter at a time, you might protect yourself against hackers who are trying to hack stuff and inject files onto your file system. I don't know this stuff, but yeah, this logged just fine, so string seems okay. I don't know that we need to know whether something is an integer or a string. So let's see. Yeah, I'm not surprised that somebody who doesn't know a ton about coding could be watching this. Somebody who probably knows coding is probably like turned off the display. And maybe even the audio, just because my quality of analysis isn't that great. I'm very much struggling to understand what the code does. I could see somebody looking at this and saying, ha ha ha, that's entertaining, just watching the lines of code float by. Alright, OBS val unused variable, line 565. Okay, let's go there. Unused variable, sure. It's one less warning to deal with. That's cool. Add this. Let's stop that. Install. Start the server. Localhost 5000. Okay, and examine the. The hell? What the hell? Still, well, okay. Got the category this time. What's going on here? So yeah, we're still not getting board zero there. Why not? I thought this would be simple to fix. Let's try it this way, I guess. I don't understand why there's a difference. This should be okay though, right? That should make no difference whatsoever. But maybe it does. Also, whoops. Let's just add one more check in here. It's now occurred to me the right way to do this. Or, wait, do I need all these parentheses? This is really confusing me. X or Y, that's the deal. Is this too many? No, that's just right. That's not what I expected to find there. There we go. That looks right. What have I got here? Oh, cool. I'm off mute. I'm actually a few minutes late wrapping this up, which is not that great either. I have done a little bit of video splicing and such, using Linux. Nothing interactive, but I have on occasion had some occasion to do that. I don't remember what the occasion was. Yeah, sharing is caring. It's a collaborative process, and people learn when they communicate with each other. And yeah, I like what Twitch is doing with the whole creative thing. It's pretty cool. Although some people use it just to broadcast music, but what can you do? The side effect of that is that I'm mostly rambling, as I try to figure things out. Thank goodness, finally. Check that out. Player has a hawk and elephant in hand. Player has a hawk and elephant in hand. That's what I've been failing to do for the longest time here. Okay, I see your link. Yeah, if I want to check it out, I'm now advised where it's at. Cool. I'll briefly check it out. I have little interest in video editing, but maybe there's something I could maybe learn that I could teach other people. So, never hurts to share, I guess. Examine the CR1 chests. That still fails. That's okay. Separate issue there. I don't understand why that failed, but we're on the right track. Oh, okay, cool. It's good to know. Oh, wait. There's a way I can simplify this. Move this line of code up here, over there, and a condition here. Magic. Magic is done. It's still not good enough. Wait, no, it is. Yeah, it is. The previous condition used to check, do we have a category but not a board? This now more efficiently checks if I'm reading and I've got a category, read the category, and if I've got a board, put that into the board parameter. Otherwise, if I don't have a board, just use zero as the default board. However, if not, the category is not specified, then we don't need to do this. So this is all as optimal as possible. Yeah, that's. To be honest, Swish, that is kind of the deal, is that chess coding's taking a higher priority here. I expect that learning TensorFlow, like learning TF-learn, which is the beginner's version of TensorFlow, is something I could accomplish. Learning TensorFlow itself is an enormous time sink, and it's the cutting edge in development, and so. I don't have the time to learn TensorFlow per se. I've got time to learn TF-learn, to figure out how it is to like hit keys on a keyboard and get some neural networky sorts of things to happen. I have time for that. My chess development at the moment is taking priority over that because I don't really have a constructive goal for that at the moment. If I had something that was motivated to try to do some machine learning on, that could be fun. But at the moment, I'm doing some chess things before I get eventually back to some machine learning things. I just burned out on that front because I don't know. I've set up a few projects trying to do some of this neural networking stuff, and I just. There's just so many details in the API, and if you don't follow it to the letter, if you're trying to like make your own examples, it's challenging. So what I used was actually Siraj's videos and his GitHub and all that, which he references all over the place. He links to himself, like somebody who's good at self-promoting. So that's how I learned just the coding for it. Back in college, I took a class in data mining, so I actually know all the theory. I just couldn't be bothered to actually write code because figuring out how to use these libraries is it's a huge time sink. for those who don't understand the theory and or don't really understand their APIs that well. Elon Musk did something with a project he calls OpenAI, Jim. And he recently partnered with Microsoft on that front, and I was optimistic until that point, but it seems to be the cutting edge on just, I want to learn neural networks, I want to come up with new challenges, I want to come up with new approaches to all existing problems. I forget whether it's openai.jim.com or something, or jim.openai.com or org, or I don't remember where it's at. But your favorite internet search engine will tell you. Yeah, I'm struggling to come up with more things to say at this point. There's got to be a better way I can put this in place. Well, this has no bearing on whether... I'm sorry, yeah, no, we have to read in the board before we can get to this. Let's do it like this, even though now, for symmetry's sake, it just is useful to stick those braces there. All the stuff. There we go. That's still fine. There we go. If we have a category like this, this can actually go up here. That's the most concise way to write this. The fact that it's not been concise this whole time has been bothersome to me. But now we've got it. Oh no. He wants to see all the pixels. I mean, what's my bitrate at? It's 800, dude. Yeah, there's nothing I can do. Twitch doesn't allow me to broadcast at a lower bitrate, I don't think. It'll tell you my internet connection sucks if I... So, the solution, Swish, is that we have to get me partnered on Twitch. And once I'm partnered on Twitch, then you can, like, every time I broadcast, say, I want to view this stream in mobile settings, and it'll stream it to you, as if you're listening, say, on a tin cup at the end of a string. It can give you that level of quality, but only if I get... Okay. He has to run, but... Oh, okay. Cool. Yeah, I'll take a look at that. Just also be forewarned, this isn't the only thing I do. There's anything on that front where... I have to, like, let you guys know, hey, I'm playing chess. Hey, I'm playing Go. Hey, I'm playing a computer game. I'm playing Nintendo. Oh, now I'm coding again. Nosewish, that's on you, man. You have to help me get partnered. Yeah, I don't know. You're the one who suggested it, not me. I'm just kidding. But, yeah. Oh no, my audio's been cutting out. That sucks. I'll have to listen to the video on demand and see, like, if the video quality is equally atrocious on that end. But on that note, I think let's stop the server, make install, start the server, and get status, bit add this file. There's still more work to do in terms of documenting this properly, so I'll handle that offline. We'll do one last test here. I know I've been saying that for so long here, but I really do have to run. So examine B01, cool. Unexamine, examine, brings up just a plain examine board. Unexamine, examine, B010, does not work, that should work. Examine B01, well, that's not working, but wild CR1 works. So, still got a use case to fix. This should work. This needs to be supported. But nobody's going to try that, honestly. But if they do, I should still try to make that work. So, yeah, we finally figured out the right works, figured out how to validate the commands and the parameters and all that fun stuff, figured out how changing the specification of the command inside command list.h ended up changing the value that got put into the string. And after all that exercise, we figured out that the existing implementation could be simplified greatly by making many assumptions that are validated by the fact that we're able to specify in the command parser that these have to be words or strings or integers and all that stuff. Or words or integers. So we have a greater control over at the parse level what we expect to see in a command, and the command is simply ignored if it doesn't follow the format. Anyway, yeah, I do have to run. It's been fun. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Bye.